Welcome to Spotlight on the Web. Hypocrites, well did Isaiah prophesy about you, saying, these people draw near to me with their mouth and honor me with their lips, but he said that their heart is far from me, and in vain they worship me, teaching as doctrines the commandments of men. Once again, we welcome you to Spotlight on the Web. What we'd like you to do at this moment is that kindly share this particular lesson with your friends. And as well, don't forget to also like and also comment where necessary. If you have questions, do not also forget to share the questions with us. I'm very glad to read your questions before we end today's discussion. We have been studying the subject of Christmas for about 2 times now. For about 2 weeks, we have been studying the concept of Christmas. And it is that there is no Christ in Christmas. And today we are looking at the part 3 of this lesson. What we'd like you to do once again is that kindly get a Bible. If you do not have one, get a piece of paper or a book and a pen or any writing material so that you can join us to study. The things that we are studying from the beginning, I have always said, and I've stated that a lot of error has been taught. A lot of misconceptions have been built around the birth of Christ. So it becomes my burden to take away all these errors. How do I do that? By exposing them with the Bible. Because God says in 1 Thessalonians 5, verse 21, that test all things, hold fast to that which is true. So that is what you are doing in this particular episode. There is no Christ in Christmas. We have been studying with you and we have been discussing this concept for a time now. We have noticed some things. But you see, today is the 23rd of December 2018. In 2 days, that is on the 25th of December 2018, a lot of people, a lot of respected people, should I say, and a lot of unrespected people as well, Christians, unchristians alike, atheists, theists, deists, agnostics, skeptics, a lot of everybody would be celebrating a particular festival. What is that festival? They call that festival Christmas. And what is Christmas? They are telling us that they are celebrating it in honor of Christ, to remember the birth of Christ. You see, if you have not heard, then you would have seen something. If you have not seen, you would smell something. You would smell that the aroma of the stew and soup and the in our mother's kitchens, they are smelling differently from the usual smell that you can smell from them. The normal scent you always hear, particularly the 2 days to this particular, you will smell something different. And you will know that the Christmas is around. Today we are going to discuss Christmas, and emphatically we'll be looking at our country Ghana. We'll be looking at our country Ghana because we are in Ghana. Yes, you make application to other countries as well, but we'll be focusing on Ghana. You see, some are saying that, when especially on Facebook, when you read comments on people's timeline, what they're saying is that put Christ back in Christmas. Let us put Christ back in Christmas. And others are saying that, oh no, Christ is the reason for the season. Some people are saying Christ is the reason for the season. Like I've been telling you, here in Kwame Nkrumah University of Science and Technology, now we are on break. But before we went for the break, a lot of denominations had what we call carols service. Probably your church that you attend, you've already had your carols night. Maybe you are yet to have it. What is this carols night? And you'll be hearing songs that they'll be singing. And one of the popular songs is that the first Noel. And it goes like this. The first Noel, the angels do say, and let me quickly summarize that. I say that the angel did say was to certain poor shepherds in fields as they lay. And he says, in fields where they lay in keeping their sheep, continue. He says that on a cold winter's night, that was so deep. And he continues, Noel, Noel, Noel. What is Noel? It's another way of saying Christmas. Did you realize something in that carol song? He says, on a cold winter's night. And from our last lesson, from last week's lesson, we realized that it is not true that when Jesus Christ was born, there was winter. And we examined that from Luke chapter 2, from verse number 8. We realized that it could not be possible because the sheep look at the song. He says, on a cold winter night, and he says the shepherds were keeping their sheep. How is that possible in the fields? It's not possible. And you see, one other thing that you hear a lot of times, aside this, in Ghana, is a song called Jingle Bell. Jingle Bell, Jingle Bell, Jingle All the Way, and a lot of news about Jingle Bell. And it goes like, it says, Jingle Bell, Jingle Bells, Jingle All the Way. Oh, what fun it is to ride in a one horse open sleigh. Oh, in Ghana, do you know about this one horse open sleigh? And he continues to say that, dashing through the snow. Oh, Ghana, when did we last see snow in Ghana? But a lot of our carol songs, you hear them sing, dashing through the snow. Where is that snow? You see, when we want to tell the truth, people always want to attack us. And what we are discussing about that, whether Christ is in Christmas or not, and my position has always been this, that there is no Christ in Christmas. And that I have affirmed and approved. Today we'll be concluding. And so we'll be looking at some of the things that we said in our previous lesson. You see, there is something that I stated clearly. That even if Christmas is something that comes from God, then he needs to emphasize certain things to us. When you look on the board that I have behind me, I've stated some things on the 2 points that I've stated on this board. The first I've stated that sincerity is not enough. Sincerity is not enough. Why am I saying that sincerity is not enough? Last week when I discussed this concept with you, I made certain things clear that there are certain misconceptions about the birth of Christ. That is to say, there are certain lies that men have propounded concerning the birth of Christ. One of them that today I'll be looking at, last week I didn't look at them. If you have not watched our previous video, I would encourage that you go and watch that particular video. There is no Christ in Christmas 2. Go back and watch it, where I stated those things that are misconceptions about the birth of Christ. But I left one thing out. That is concerning one very popular statement. What is that? That statement is that Jesus Christ was born in a stable. What is a stable? A stable is a place where they feed horses, where they keep horses and certain farm animals. And people get this concept because they read Luke chapter 2. Kindly, let's turn our scriptures. Luke 2, verse number 8. And in reading this text, they concluded that then Jesus should be born in a stable. But is that very true? This is the last misconception I would like to look at. Then we can move on with our discussion. Luke 2, verse number 7. Says that, and she brought forth her firstborn son and wrapped him in a swaddling cloth and laid him in a manger because there was no room for them in the inn. So by stating manger, then a lot of people concluded that Jesus Christ was born in a stable. You see, do not read meanings into the scriptures. Let the scriptures interpret themselves. Even reading verse 7, we realized something last week, that people have said that the innkeeper sent them away, that there was no room for them, so go away. And so they left and they went to other places. Oh, we realized from our last study that that is not true. Why is that statement not true? Jesus Christ was born at this place, and he says that, and laid him in a manger because there was no room for them in the inn. Now, what is this particular statement? This word that you see here called inn. You can only see it in other two places in the entire scriptures. Which places can you see that? In the New Testament, you can find it in the book of Luke, chapter 22, verse number 11. And also, you can find it in Mark chapter 14, verse number 14. This word here that you see translated as in, it comes from this Greek word called kataluma. And it simply means guest house or guest chamber. That is the meaning of the word. So you see, what it says is that there was no room for them in the guest chamber. Go back and read more about this particular statement that we are referring to. It is stated by Bible archaeologists that it was not even probable for Mary and Joseph to have stayed in that place. And so Jesus Christ was giving birth in a relative's house.
Not even in some open place. No. So that is also a misconception. He was not also born in a stable. That is also false. So you see, and one thing that I've said from the beginning that today I will say again is the three wise men. Where do we see that in the scriptures? The Bible says there were no three wise men. The Bible did not mention a number. He said wise men. That was not God's concern. Just as the day that Christ was born is not the concern of God. You see, I stated something that sincerity is not enough. A lot of us do not know that these are lies that have been said about the birth of Christ. So we were celebrating Christmas. Concerning the day that Christ was born, we stated and we mentioned the person who chose 25th December, who mentioned and said, oh, it is 25th that Christ was born. Who was that? In our previous lesson, we stated that it was Africanus Julius Aurelius. Who is that? Sextus Julius Africanus. He did that in 221 AD. And I said we are in 2018 AD. So when you go back in time, 221 AD, that is the guy who selected that day, 25th December. This answered that question that a lot of you have been sending me on WhatsApp and calling to ask that, well, we are choosing that day ourselves. Nobody, we decided to choose 25th December, so you can't tell us that we could have chosen any other day. So don't, no, you are not the one who chose 25th December. You were not the one who chose. So that's why I'm telling you that sincerity is not enough. Maybe you are not aware. You are sincere. Sincerely, you didn't know that these are misconceptions. These are lies that men have told about the birth of Christ. So you were doing it. Now you know. You see, we mentioned a passage. John 8, verse number 44. Where we are told that Satan is the father of all lies. And when he speaks a lie, the Bible says that he speaks from his own resources. He does not speak from the resources of any other person. His own resource, he can't prove the things he says. That is why you cannot find Christmas in the Bible. But men still want to do it. This brings us to our second point. Christmas. Who is giving the command? Is it coming from God or is it coming from man? Christmas. Who is giving you the instruction, the command for you to celebrate Christmas? Is it coming from God or is it coming from man? The first passage we read before we began our lesson today, Matthew 15, verse number 7 to verse number 9. The Bible says this, hypocrites, well did Isaiah prophesy about you saying? He says that these people draw near to me with their mouth and honor me with their lips, but their heart is far from me. And he continues to say that, and in vain they worship me, teaching as doctrines the commandments of men. So you see, my brother, my sister, my dear friend, you can be worshiping God, but all that you'll be doing will be in vain. Why? When would your worship be in vain? When the things that you practice, they are teachings and commandments of men. When you teach commandments and you practice things of men, then your worship will be in vain. A lot of you have asked me this question on WhatsApp, and I've met some of you, we've interacted, and you asked me that, Derek, so what you are telling us is that if I celebrate Christmas, I'll go to hell? What is wrong with that? I decided to just celebrate the birth of Christ. I told you the last time that I don't have a problem with you trying to remember the birth of Christ. That is up to you. But you see, to say that 25th December, to choose December, at that time that we are to use to remember Christ and tell all these lies that the Bible says so, and even give passages, and go for carols night and read passages, then you have a problem. That is why we are saying there is no Christ in Christmas. There is no Christ in Christmas. Now, let us look at a very beautiful point. What point are we going to look at this point in time? Christmas is not from God. We've seen that. It's from man. So it's not up to you to decide. In Jeremiah chapter 24, verse 15, we are told that Jeremiah decided that for him and his household, they will serve the Lord. He said, choose ye this day whom ye will serve, God or mammon. So you to choose today whether you want to obey God or man. Remember, sincerity is not enough. You didn't know, today you know. So what will you do with this information that you have? Because Christmas is not from God, look at certain things. Let me quickly clean this and let's look at the next thing. Because Christmas is not from God, these things have become problems for us. How to celebrate Christmas? There's a lot of confusion about it. It is not known. Because it's not from God, we do not know how to celebrate Christmas. So I told you the last time that when you go outside, when you travel outside Ghana, places like when we mentioned, aside England, aside United States, where they don't celebrate Christmas on December 25th, but they have days like March 6th, they have days like August 25th, these are different days. And I ask you a question, when was the last time Santa Claus visited you in your house? My dear listener, when was the last time Santa Claus visited you? When was the last time you used mistletoe in celebrating Christmas? When was the last time you used Christmas tree? You see, we do not know how to observe it. We just not know. The next thing, when to celebrate it is not also known. When are we to celebrate? Is it December 25th? Is it March 6th? And last time I gave you an evidence, and I'd like to read that evidence to you. That evidence came from the Catholic Encyclopedia. And I'd like to read that. It says this. He says, the time that we are supposed to celebrate this particular feast, as to whether it is March 6th, good. Let's read. He says that before the 5th century, this comes from the Encyclopedia Britannica, volume 5, page 641. I believe by now you have checked it and you have seen that it's true. He says, before the 5th century, there was no consensus of opinions as to when it should come in the calendar, whether January 5th, March 25th, or December 25th. This comes from Encyclopedia. They could not determine. So the question is, who chose that now it is 25th? And I've given you that person. So you see that it is not coming from God. And because it is not coming from God, we have the problem about the when to observe this particular celebration. Now, I have even taken the position, assuming God has given that instruction. These are not new, and it will bring confusion. And once it brings confusion, then we should know that it is not with God. Because God is not the author of confusion. Now, the next thing is, what to do? What to do on this particular Christmas day? What are we to do? We don't know what to do. A lot of things are done. And you see, because it's not coming from God, specifically, the Bible has given us no information. He has given us no information. So now you see, it becomes your own choosing. What you want to do to remember Christ, that's what you do. And unfortunately, in December, before we enter January 2019, a lot of pharmacies will sell a lot of condoms. They will sell a lot of them. Why? Because men choose this time to do a lot of orgy, a lot of sexually illicit stuff, sexually immoral stuff. And that is why people are saying that, let us put Christ back in Christmas. That's why people are saying that Christ is the reason for the season, so that people would, and no, go up to the origin of Christmas. That was what was being done, debauchery. Licentiousness, lewdness, that is what is characterized with Christmas. It was not the birthday of Christ, it was the birthday of the sun god, Saturnalia. And that those were the things they did. So people are just repeating it. Christ has nothing to do with Christmas. He has nothing to do with it. You see, and we have seen clearly. Now, to answer some of the objections that people have raised concerning this particular subject that I'm teaching, there is no Christ in Christmas. Somebody asked me a question. So Derek, is it actually true that if I celebrate Christmas, I'm remembering the birth of Christ, with all these lies associated with it, what will happen to me? I was very quiet. I looked at this gentleman's face and I told him this. Can you turn your scriptures to Revelation 2 verse number 12? Revelation 2 verse number 12 to verse number 17. We are going to discuss a certain church. Yes, it is the church of Christ. But that church that you read of in the Bible says that they were the compromising church. They were the church that entertained error. So if you are a man of God, if you are a preacher, if you are a deacon, if you are a bishop, if you are a church leader listening to me at this particular moment, if you can hear me, then note this. God says something concerning this compromising church. That church that supported error, that church that entertained error. What did God tell them? Then that answer, take it for yourself. Revelation 2, verse number 12 to verse number 17. What are the scriptures teach? If you may, let us read. Revelation 2, 7, 12 to 17. And to the angel of the church in Pergamos write, these things says he who has the sharp two-edged sword, and the two-edged sword is the word of God. Hebrews tells us that. Continue reading. Verse 13. I know your works and where you dwell, where Satan's throne is, and you hold fast to my name and did not deny my faith, even in the days in which Antipas was my faithful martyr, who was killed among you where Satan dwells. Continue reading. But I have few things against you, because you have there those who hold the doctrine of Balaam, who taught Balak to put a stumbling block before the children of Israel, to eat things sacrificed to idols, to commit sexual immorality. And he continues saying that, thus you also have those who hold the doctrines of Nicolaitans, which then I hate. You see the type of doctrines they were holding? They were holding false doctrines, things that God hated. Let me use this opportunity to say this. This evening at 6 o'clock, I'll be live again, and I'll be teaching the subject of Armageddon and the concept about 666. You see, reading Revelations, this church, they were entertaining error. What did God tell them? Verse 16, repent. God says, repent. Did he just say that? Or else I will come to you quickly and I will fight against them with the sword of my mouth. If you are a church celebrating Christmas in honor of Christ, if you are an individual celebrating Christmas in honor of the birth of Christ, I'm telling you, based on the scriptures, that repent. Repent. Why should you repent? Because when you lie against God, you will not go scot-free. If your congregation you do that, your lampstand will be kicked away. This really scares me. Paul says in 1 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 11, he says, therefore, knowing the terror of God, we persuade men. Knowing the terror of God, we persuade men. Do not make a mistake. Sincerity is not enough. Sincerity is not enough. You see, one other thing that we like to note is that, okay, fine. Now, we have seen what God did not specify, that he did not tell us to use Christmas to remember him. And I promise you that before we end the subject of Christmas, we would note and know what Christ specifically stated that we should use to remember him. What did Christ say we should use to remember him? Did he ever say anything like that in the Bible about something that men should use to remember him? If he did, was it Christmas? The Bible has told us that no, it is not Christmas. So what then is it? In Matthew 26, verse 26, and I'll be very glad to write that. In Matthew 26, verse number 26, he says this. Matthew 26, verse 26 to verse 30. Also, you can read this in Mark 14, verse number 22 to verse number 25. You can again read this in Luke chapter 22, verse 19 to verse number 20. These are the three places where you can read about what Christ stated that we ought to use to remember him. If we are to turn our scriptures, let us turn and find out what he said we should use to remember him. Luke chapter 22, verse number 19. You can keep on sending your comments and your questions and be glad to respond to them. If you have not shared the video, kindly do share for us. Luke 22, verse 19 to 20. And he took bread, gave thanks and broke it, and gave it to them, saying, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. So you see, Christ specifically, emphatically, clearly stated what we ought to use to remember him. He did not leave it blank so that you will fix in Christmas, so that you will fix in Easter, so that you will fix in any other festivity. No, he specifically stated that use the Lord's Supper to remember me. His death, his burial, his resurrection. So are we too smart than Jesus Christ himself? That Jesus Christ did not know that we could use his birth to remember him, and he decided to use his death and his burial. You see, because he specifically stated this, that do this in remembrance of me, let us find out whether he told us how, where, how and why we ought to remember him. Did he give us these informations? If Christ specifically said we should use the Lord's Supper to remember him, we should look for the places that he has stated that we ought to remember him. The first thing that we ask, the first question we ask is that, where? And give the passages. And sorry, when are we to remember him? Is it December 25th? About the Lord's Supper, when are we supposed to take it? Is it December 25th? Is it once every month? Is it once every week? Is it when I am about to marry? Is it when I am about to give birth? When are we supposed to do this particular festivity? This particular observation that Christ said, do this in remembrance of me. When are we supposed to do that? Let us turn our scriptures. Acts 20, verse number 7. Acts 20, verse 7, and also Acts chapter 2, verse number 42. Acts 2, verse 42. These are the two places where you can find when Christians are supposed to take the Lord's Supper. He specifically stated it, and I like to read. Remember, in Matthew 26, he had told them that he will not partake of it with them again until in his Father's kingdom. Let us read Acts 20, verse number 7. Now, on the first day of the week, when the disciples came together, so note that condition, first day of the week, when they came together to do what? Continue reading. When the disciples came together to break bread, Paul, ready to depart the next day, spoke to them and continued his message until midnight. That was the Lord's Supper. Breaking of bread. Breaking of bread. This breaking of bread is not eating food. No. It's not the normal food, the common meal they were partaking of. No. Acts chapter 2, verse 42 also emphasized. Remember, Acts 2, verse 1. He has said that now when the day of Pentecost had fully come. What day is the day of Pentecost? It is the first of the week. The first day of the week. We'll be reading your questions very, very soon. Let's read about, so you can read that from the scriptures. Now, about where? Where did he say that we ought to do this particular observation? And we can read that also in 1 Corinthians 11, verse 20. That is, when Christians come together. When Christians come together. Let me write the passage. Acts 20, verse 7. He mentioned when Christians come together. And 1 Corinthians 11, verse 20. When you come together to break bread. Then he also mentioned how. How we ought to remember him. He told us. 1 Corinthians chapter 11. Verse number 23, then when you read verse number 27, he will tell you how we ought to remember him. That is insanity. Let us go and read that. And you see that it is in direct contrast with what people do on Christmas Day. 1 Corinthians 11, verse number 27. Therefore, whoever eats this bread or drinks this cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of the body and the blood of the Lord. You need to do this in purity and in holiness. So you see, it is not about, in my church, we want to do it every month. In my church, we want, no. What did the Bible say? Every first day of the week. How? In a worthy manner. Now, why? 1 Corinthians 11, 23 says, do this in remembrance of me. No Christmas. No Christmas. Before we read your comments, before we take all these things, I like to note, sincerity is not enough. God and man, who will you listen to? I will choose the side of God. Which side will you also choose? Let us read some of the comments and some of the questions that have come to us this day. Alright, so we have Akaria saying that he's watching today. Akaria, thank you very much for watching. We have Intifu Esiedu Jerry, says great work Derek, God bless you. Thank you so much for watching us today. Okay, I think Esiedu has a question. It says, can Christmas be celebrated as a non-religious festivity, just as the Independence Day and Farmers Day? Waiting for your answer. Okay, very good. Let's answer that, then we'll take it again. When last time when we discussed Christmas in our first lesson, I made a statement that when you go to America, they have legalized the celebration of Christmas as a public holiday. So when you heard me in my speech today, when I was talking about Christmas, I told you about how atheists, even atheists, observe this day. Skeptics who do not believe God, who do not believe that even God exists, they observe this day. They mount and have they have fun with their families, they meet together and they enjoy with their families, not in remembrance of Christ. So yes, you see, in Ghana specifically, let me ask a question. How do you celebrate Christmas? So yes, your question is answered. It has two sides, and you can verify that. We have the secular aspect and have the religious aspect. When you mingle the two, then you have problems. Then you have problems. So yes, that question is answered. Now let me be quick to say this also. In Christianity, in Galatians 4, verse number 8, last week we read that particular passage. So let me go back and read that. He says that, but then indeed, when you did not know God, you served those which by nature are not gods. But now, after you have known God, or rather are known by God, how is it that you turn again to the weak and beggarly element, to which you desire again to be in bondage? Now see this. You observe days and months and seasons and years. Who was he talking to? Christians. And he continues to say that, I am afraid for you, lest I have labored for you in vain. Christians have no command to observe Christmas in honor of Christ. Yes, it has a secular observation and it has a religious observation, but you need to be very, very careful. If you claim that you are celebrating Christmas, not in honor of Christ, yet you are singing Jingle Bell, you are singing all these things in relation to Christ, then what are you doing? You are only deceiving yourself. And so I wouldn't want to even associate myself with it. Why? Because I want to be on the side of God. God has given us no command on that. Esther Futu says, what do you say to one who wishes you a Merry Christmas? Is it a personal question? Esther, are you asking a personal question that do I respond to people who wish me Merry Christmas? If you wish me Merry Christmas, my dear, I will not respond to you. Because in Ghana, all those who wish me Merry Christmas, they are doing that in honor of Christ. And God has given us no command. So why Merry Christmas? Why do you tell me first Noel? Why do you tell me Jesus Christ was born in December? No, I will not respond to that. So if it was a personal question, I've answered. I wouldn't want to respond to that. Yes. Then we have Gloria Obeying, said K. Asari, Emmanuel Anoche, Richmond, Kwesi Ansan, you are all watching and we say that God richly bless you. God richly bless you. Gloria Obeying says that God richly bless you, Derek, more knowledge and wisdom. We believe more comments would come in the future and we'd like to say that. Thank you very much. Let's be very, very careful. Now, before we end and leave you, we read a last passage, 2 Timothy 4, verse 2 to verse number 5. But before I read this passage, let me say this. Because Christmas has a secular celebration, because it has a secular aspect, be very, very careful. I know of congregations where on 25th December, they will meet in their assembly and they will worship. Why are you meeting to worship? Independence Day, do you meet in your auditorium to worship? Do you do that? I've not heard that answer. Maybe you can type the answer at our comment section. Do you do that? You see, if you claim that it is a personal observation, keep it as a secular personal celebration. Do not mingle it with Christianity. So when you do that in that auditorium, when you meet for carol service and you tell me that it is a secular observation, you are telling lies and you are not being sincere to yourself. You are not being sincere. When you tell me that it's a secular observation, but you are meeting to pray and remember the birth of Christ, my brother, my sister, you are making a mistake. You are still observing as a religious festivity. So don't make a mistake. You see, it is very, very dicey. In order not to fall into any trap, and in order to fall in any, to have any problems with God and His word, stay safe from, and God has always said, let us flee from the devil. These are the schemes of the devil. I can't leave you without stating this. You see, a lot of preachers in Ghana, a lot of men of God in Ghana, use this season to gain a lot of financial benefits from you. Yes, they gain a lot of financial benefits from you. Why don't they treat Lord's Supper in the same way they treat Christmas? You want to remember Christ. Christ says, use the Lord's Supper to remember me. So if you want to do that, why don't you emphasize and celebrate the Lord's Supper like the way you celebrate Christmas? When? Upon the first day of the week, Sunday morning, he says, in a worthy manner, live a holy life. Life that is worthy. So that on the first day of the week, we will see you, Akosia Mansan. We will see you, Elizabeth. We will see you, Mary. We will see you, Amma. Oh, on that particular day, Akosi. And you know something, Michael, on that particular day, you live a pure and holy life so that you can partake of the Lord's Supper. That is when you have become a Christian. When you allow yourself to believe the gospel, to repent of your sins. And we have mentioned one, let us repent from celebration of Christmas. You see, when you have repented, then you allow yourself to be immersed in water, just as God has told us to do. Then God will add you to his fold. God will add you to his church. That church we read of in the Bible. So that you can partake of the Lord's Supper. So that you can remember Christ in the way that he has told us to remember him. If indeed, my dear brother, you want to remember Christ, repent and be baptized so that God will add you to his fold. 2 Timothy 4, verse 2 to verse 5. I promise to read this passage and I'm very, very glad if you can turn your scriptures to that place. I read. Preach the word. Be ready in season and out of season. Convince, rebuke, exhort with all longsuffering and teaching. Verse 3. For the time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine. Men will not want to endure sound doctrine. Continue. But according to their own desires, because they have itching ears, they will heap up for themselves teachers. Note what he says. And they will turn their ears from the truth and be turned aside to fables. Verse 4. And they will turn their ears away from the truth and be turned aside to fables. But verse 5 says that what? But you be watchful in all things, endure afflictions, do the work of an evangelist, fulfill your ministry. This was Paul's statement to the young preacher Timothy. As he stated this, I would like to tell you the same thing. Please, please and please again, do not have itching ears. Don't turn your ear away from this truth, but rather embrace this truth and repent and be baptized so that God will add you to his church. So we meet again. This is Derek Danso, and we say that God richly bless you. The churches of Christ salute you. Bye-bye.